Laudetur Jesus Christus, praised be Jesus Christ. And we welcome you to this live-streamed broadcast of the briefing of the 16th General Assembly of the Ordinary General Assembly of the Synod of Bishops. And today is Wednesday, October 18th, 2023. We're broadcasting this Synod briefing from the Holy See Press Office. And from wherever you are joining us, we would like to welcome you to this live broadcast. Some of you may be joining us through various Vatican media channels, perhaps the Vatican Media Live Events app or the Radio Vaticana app, the Vatican News web portal or Vatican News English YouTube channel, or our Facebook Live feed. A very warm welcome to you all. My name is Devin Watkins, and I'll be assisted today by various simultaneous translators who are working for the Synod of Bishops and are translating things for the various participants in the Paul VI Hall where the Synod is being held. For those of you following on with a screen, you can see that we are still waiting for the participants in today's briefing to make their way to the Holy See Press Office. They will be accompanied by Dr. Paolo Ruffini, who is the president of the Synod's Commission for Information, as well as Ms. Sheila Pires, who is the secretary of the Commission for Information of the Synod. This morning, participants in the Synod on synodality began the day with Holy Mass in St. Peter's Basilica. This was followed by the 12th General Congregations of the Synod. This was this opened the newest module of B3 of the Instrumentum Laboris. We also live-streamed this event this morning. And now we see that Dr. Ruffini is making his way to the press office, up onto the stage with several of the guests from the Synod Hall who are joining him to speak to reporters from various news agencies accredited to the Holy See.
Buongiorno.
Good morning. This is from Christiane Murray, who is the Deputy Director of the Holy See Press Office. She's welcoming all the journalists to the present today.
As usual.
And she welcomes Dr. Ruffini and Sheila and their four guests, who she will introduce with these present translators.
Bernard Steiner, we know him well. He belongs to the order of Friars Minor. He was born in the Brazilian state of Santa Catarina into a family of German origin, and he was ordained a priest in 1978 by his cousin, Cardinal Paolo Evaristo Arms. In 2005, Pope John Paul II appointed him prelate of São Félix do Araguaia, succeeding Pedro Casalgaliga Pla. In 2011, Pope Benedict appointed him Auxiliary Bishop of Brasilia, and he was also elected General Secretary of the Conference. And in 2019, he returned to the Amazon, chosen by Pope Francis as Archbishop of Manaus. Manaus is the most populous city in the Amazon, with more than 2.1 million inhabitants. On 29 May 2022, last year, at the end of the Regina Coeli, Pope Francis announced his creation as a cardinal. Cardinal Steiner is currently president of CIMI, which is the indigenous missionary council. We also have Monsignor Zbigniew Stankiewicz, Archbishop of Riga in Latvia since 2010. He comes from a family of Polish origin, and he was born in Lady Lasiams in 1955. He has held several pastoral positions, and this is the fifth synod he participates in. He's General Secretary of the Latvian Bishops' Conference. Then we have His Excellency Pablo Virgilio David, who was born in Betis in the Philippines on 2nd March 2059. He's currently Bishop of Caloocan, and since 2021 he's President of the Catholic Bishops' Conference of the Philippines. In 2019, the University of Manila awarded him the Bukas Palat Prize for his service to the poor and for his courage in speaking out against the evil of injustice and violence. He's the author at the academic level and for the general public of several publications on the Holy Scriptures, and he's considered one of the country's leading experts in biblical studies. And then we have Wyatt Olivas, an American citizen. He's the youngest participant in the Synod. He's 19. He's a student at the University of Wyoming in Laramie and has participated as a missionary in the Catholic youth program Totus Tuus, sharing his faith with Catholic youth throughout Wyoming. In addition, he's a catechist in his home diocese of Cheyenne. Witnessing the synodal process from the beginning, he said in an interview, "It filled my heart with joy to see that the Church wishes to listen to young people." Welcome to all our guests. We're now going to give the floor to Mr. Ruffini. Thank you. I'm only going to take up a few minutes this morning. This morning you saw the live streaming of the 12th General Congregation, and so you have already had the opportunity of listening to what has occurred. This afternoon and tomorrow morning, the small circles, we are going to look at the themes in worksheet B3. So we are going to speak about the relationship between authority and responsibility in the ecclesial structures of a church that wishes to be increasingly synodal and missionary. Tomorrow afternoon, there's going to be the 13th General Congregation. And at the end, in St. Peter's Square, there's going to be the prayer for migrants and refugees. And perhaps Sheila is going to tell you something more about it. As you know about this, the press room will provide an opportunity for you to follow this. At the end of the General Congregation of this morning, Cardinal Olerich informed the Assembly concerning the meetings of the Commission for the Synthesis Document, particularly on the nature that this text will have as chosen by the Commission. It will be short and at the service of a process which continues. So it's going to be a transitional text, temporary, based on the experiences of the Assembly, including points of consensus and points of disagreement. It's going to contain open questions which will require canonical, theological, and pastoral deepening together with the people of God. The synthesis report is not a final document, the Cardinal explained, and it's not even the instrumentum laboris for the next assembly. The style is going to be simple, and the goal of this document consists in accompanying the subsequent phases. The Commission has thought also to draft a letter message to tell the entire people of God and to as many people as possible, and particularly to those who have not yet been reached or informed or also involved in the synodal process. The experience that the brothers and sisters, members of the synod, bishops and non-bishops have made. The Secretariat of the Synod, in accordance with the Pope, has submitted this voting to the Assembly. There were 348 members present for the voting of this proposal. Voters, 346. The absolute majority, 175. Result was 335 in favor and 11 votes against. The proposal was therefore approved with a very broad majority. I'm going to give the floor to Sheila now for some other pieces of information. Thank you.
Boa tarde, good afternoon, buongiorno. So today we began a little bit on a sad note this morning as we were informed of the sudden death of His Excellency Monsignor Robert Camilleri Azopardi, the Bishop of Comayaga, President of the Episcopal Conference of Honduras. And so we joined in prayer. We observed a moment of silence, and we joined in prayer also with the members from Honduras present in the hall, His Most Reverend Eminence Cardinal Oscar Rodriguez Maradiaga, His Most Reverend Excellency Bishop Jose Nasher Tati, as well as Reverend Sister Maria Suyapa Cacho Alvarez. And so tomorrow afternoon, at the end of the second section, that would be in the evening, all the participants of the Synod, that is of the 16th Ordinary General Assembly of the Synod of Bishops, will be attending a Mass, a moment of prayer, rather, in St. Peter's Square in remembrance of migrants and refugees. So the Pope will also be present. And we ask all our faithful to join us in prayer via streaming, live streaming, as it will be broadcast via streaming. We also received news by Mr. Luca Cassarini. He's a special invitee to the assembly. I'm sure some of you might remember him. He joined us here some days ago. And he was talking to us about a rescue in the Mediterranean Sea of two boats, one with 47 and the other with 69 migrants, brothers and sisters from various African countries. And among them was a seven-year-old girl, Jessica, who was arriving from Cameroon with her mother. And then the second boat had many women and children, mainly from South Sudan. So the youngest there in the second boat was only 2 months old, and they've all been rescued. So that was a good news that we received this morning. Another news also that we'd like to share with you is that during the assembly, we also pray for various requests. For example, there was a request to pray for brothers and sisters or relatives of Synod participants that are in delicate situations. And so we entrusted their protection of Mary, our mother. So we prayed for them, and these are just some of the moments that we have within the assembly. We also remember those who celebrate their birthdays, anniversaries, and yeah, that's it for now. Thank you.
I would like to ask Cardinal Steiner to open this series of witness for today. The floor is yours. Good afternoon. I come from the Amazon, from a church that has a long experience in synodality. Without using the term synodality, though, a church that has always tried to involve all ministries and vocations in evangelization and in the debates. The diocesan assemblies in the region see the participation of laymen and women, and in the most recent meetings there was always a representative of the indigenous populations. We always try to invite them in order to be able to listen to them and to better carry out our mission. Religious life, well, there are presbyters, bishops, and permanent deacons. In the Church of Manaus, we have followed a synodal journey. We had already started when the Holy Father convoked the synod, and we had consulted some 1,000 communities that we have. 86% of these communities answer the questions that we sent them. And all these questions, were then sent as a contribution to the synod that we are celebrating here in Rome. It is a very great joy to be able to see that the synod is a process. And we are not looking for solutions, but we are practicing synodality in the synod. And it is evident that we will also have to make some decisions as we do in our region. But the good and significant thing is to see that everybody is trying to be a part of this synodal process, in which everybody has the opportunity of expressing themselves, speaking, and voicing one's ideas to the benefit of the Church, considering the mission of the Church. The mission of the Church, which consists in proclaiming the Gospel, the Kingdom of God. All of us in this task and in this process are united, and I think we can thank the Holy Father for convening this Synod so that we can reflect and practice synodality. For us who come from the Amazon, this is an additional incentive, a stimulus to continue along this journey, trying to listen to everybody and trying to involve everyone in the evangelizing process. We are in the Amazon region area, and we try to listen to the cultures of the regions, which are the indigenous cultures, so that starting from their culture, we can present to them the gospel, but also starting from this culture, carry out our celebrations. Thank you. Thank you, Your Eminence. I would like now to give the floor to our youngest member, Wyatt. If you have your experience, and I would imagine that this is a first synod for you.
Yes, this is my first synod. it's very exciting to be here and to really feel that the Holy Father wants to listen to everyone. When he says that he wants that the synod process is about listening, he truly means it when he says he wants to listen to everyone. A 19-year-old from Cheyenne, Wyoming, there's 68,000 people there. There's not a lot of people. But my experience here has been nothing but fruitful. It's been an amazing experience to truly just be listened to. And then hear these different perspectives from all around the world. I think it's just amazing that I get to see these other sides. So it's very, very good and very exciting to be here. Thank you.
Thank you. From the Amazon to the United States, and now we move back to Europe, giving the floor to Monsignor Stankiewicz.
Buonasera.
I come from Latvia, which is not a very big country, less than 2 million inhabitants, 20% of them are Catholics. And when we received the invitation to participate in the synodal process, there were, let's say, mixed feelings about it, because some people some initially had this feeling of rejection. Some others were a bit convinced that it would just be something formal that would just, you know, happen without considering the reality of life. So I was convinced that this invitation was, though, the Holy Spirit, the breath of the Holy Spirit, wishing to renew the Church. So we started on this journey. We invited Cardinal Gregg, who came a year ago, or actually more than a year ago in Latvia. He came to Latvia, and he helped us, and he explained to us what the Synod is. And so this is just an introduction I wanted to make. But in connection with the last few days, we have looked at the topic of co-responsibility in the mission, how to share the tasks and duties at the service of the gospel. We have worked intensely, and I would like to give you a synthesis, or my summary, let's say, of what we have done. The main task of the synod, well, the first part consists in listening to everyone, not just Catholics, but also other Christians and the representatives of the other religions, the marginalized persons, and also non-believers, and try to recognize what the Spirit wishes to tell the Church today. And then how we can expand the kingdom of God in the contemporary world, which is very different. I'm 68 years old, and I can tell you that when I was young, the world was completely different. Also in the past 30 years, since we have been independent, things have changed considerably. And here, the gold key, this is what the expression we use in Latvian, is what the Second Vatican Council used to say, awaken the sleeping giant. It means to awaken this sense of co-responsibility for the evangelizing mission of the Church in every baptized person. And here, there is a great challenge, first of all, for formation, in terms of formation, the formation of bishops, priests, because their task, main task, consists in looking to the faithful and recognize their gifts, their charisms, and awaken these charisms if they have not been awakened yet, and help discover and make grow and implement them to the service of the Church. So this was a very important dimension. The second one is a special gift that women have, and women as a gift. We spoke about women, the genius of women, because women have special gifts. But first and foremost, women are called to maternity, not just physical maternity, but also spiritual maternity. So a woman should not be in competition with men, but it is important to look at their complementarity, because a man, a male, to discover his identity, needs a mirror. A mirror is Christ himself, but as far as the visible human mirror is concerned, it is a woman who helps the other person to discover his or her identity. And the task of women is also represented by this maternal dimension that allows me to discover my gifts, drawing inspiration to higher gifts and going beyond challenges. And this is mutual, as a woman said in our group today. It's complementarity, and also appreciating women in the sense of giving them more room in the Church without changing what is in the Gospel and what is part of the Church's tradition. So this is more or less what we talked about today. Thank you very much. And now we're going to give the floor to the fourth speaker. We go to Asia with the president of the Episcopal Conference of the Philippines, His Excellency Pablo David.
Hello, good afternoon, everybody. I got used to being timed, so I hope you don't mind that I set on my timer. That's how it is in the Synod. When we ask for a free intervention, the time goes off, you know. You have to be conscious of it. So, first of all, I am from the Philippines, and you probably know that there are many Filipinos, millions of Filipinos deployed all over the world, and we call them the diaspora Filipinos. They're about 10 to 15% of the population of our country. And, you know, I get to meet a lot of Synod delegates who tell me, oh, there are Filipinos in our country, you know, and they have brought new life to our dying parishes. And, you know, we're pleasantly surprised about that. You know, Pope Francis made a joke about the Filipinos as contrabandistas de la fe. In Spanish, that would be smugglers of the faith. And, you know, our Filipino overseas workers are turning into reluctant missionaries. I say reluctant because they're not really trained to become missionaries. They just try to live their faith wherever they find themselves, no? But somehow, we, back in the Philippines, especially the bishops and the pastors, are asking ourselves if we have done our part in empowering them for mission. And I think that has been very prominent in this module about co-responsibility in mission. Because normally when we say mission, we only think of missionary congregations, you know, religious people who are sent abroad, you know, for mission. But now we're realizing that the whole church is called to mission. And that is really the objective of this synod. In fact, I'm excited about it right now because right in my diocese, we are undergoing what we call a synodal pastoral planning process. And the catchword is transforming parishes from maintenance to mission. Transforming parishes from maintenance to mission. And I say it's very exciting because the whole point is to get our laity to realize that they are co-responsible partners in mission. You cannot have a church if you don't have a church that is participating in mission. That's one of the most prominent things that I really am excited about in this synod. And secondly, you know, I was surprised when I joined this synod because it's totally different, you know. I joined the synod in 2008. It was the synod on the Word of God in the life and mission of the church. And my gosh, it was super formal, you know. There was a presidential table for the Holy Father and the relator and the Synod General Secretariat. And then you have the cardinals and the archbishops and the bishops. And since I was still an auxiliary bishop back then, I was way, you know, at the back, you know. I was just sort of looking like that, you know. I was a baby bishop. And so when I came to this synod, I was pleasantly surprised to find round tables where we were all equal. And I think that this particular synod is insistent on that. Our equality in dignity. No matter if you're cardinal or archbishop or whoever, we're all, you know, basically a community of disciples, equal in baptism. And I think this synod is more conscious about that. Before we insist on the differentiation of ministries, we have to emphasize first our equality and dignity as fellow baptized. We call that the common priesthood of the faithful, which is what the ministerial priesthood is supposed to nurture. You know? And I was surprised because I'm coming from Asia, and we're quite used to that already in Asia. We had our synodal assembly in Asia, and we also were discussing in round tables. And I was also surprised that I don't know if they consciously adopted the Asian method, because we also adopted the method of spiritual conversation, and we would stop after each intervention for silence and prayer. And of course, much of the synod is also happening during the coffee break, you know. It's not all very, very serious, you know. In the coffee break, you get to talk to one another in a more friendly way, and a lot of things are happening there also. Of course, the ministry, the concept of ministry is also being articulated in the synod. It's not only the ministry of serving the church, but the ministry of being of service to the world as part of a servant church.
Thank you, Your Excellency. I don't know if Cardinal Grech and the members of the Synod drew inspiration from the Asian assemblies or those from the Amazonia concerning the methodology. We're now going to open the floor to our journalists. There is Luis, who has raised his hand, and he hasn't taken the floor ever yet, so we give him the floor very happily.
Boa tarde. O padre Luis Miguel Modino, de Religion Digital.
Good afternoon. I come from the Diocese of Manaus. The question is for Cardinal Steiner. And I would like to ask him to explain to us this practical synodality. How does it impact on the communities, even the most distant ones, and how this support that given by the church to the indigenous population allows them to recover their identity and their rights in the face of the aggressions which are perpetrated, particularly by the Brazilian society and the public authorities. Thank you. Thank you for your question. Listening to the communities makes us understand what the communities think, but also what they are and what they would like to do and what their needs are. our communities from the remote and inland areas of Brazil are almost all presided over by women. They are guided by women, and women are calling for more formation to be able to better carry out their leadership role. And they ask for their proper ministries, for instance, that a community where the Eucharistic is seldom celebrated, well, that there may be the celebration of baptism, and for that there is no need for the actual presence of the priest, the presbyter. So the communities are becoming more and more aware that they can celebrate a sacrament as a community. But listening, for instance, in the indigenous communities in the city of Manaus, we've got 70,000 indigenous peoples, and they belong to different cultures. These cultures are all different from one another. They are very diverse. Even languages are different. So we listen to be able to understand what the needs are, what suggestions they are making, how to celebrate the Eucharist, how to support and be close to these persons, and how to take care of the environment. We all know the terrible situation in which the Amazon is at the moment, with drought and the small rivers have disappeared. They have become small sandy deserts. The great rivers of the Amazon are almost dry, and smoke comes from the burning forest. The indigenous peoples try to help us understand this reality and the relationship with the environment, and they warn us. They make us understand the need for doing what the Pope calls for, taking care of our common home. So listening to our communities in the synodal way allows us to be an active Samaritan church, a church that is present, that is merciful, but also that provides consolation. It is the communities that help us do this. So synodality for us is a great help, because the communities tell us how to be a church. It's not the bishop who tells the communities how they should be, but it's the other way around. It's the communities that help us better understand how to be a church in the reality in which we live, in the city of Manaus, almost 2 million inhabitants is the same as almost the inhabitants of Manaus are almost as many as the inhabitants of Latvia, but also the remote communities. The Archdiocese of Manaus is 94,000 square kilometers in terms of extension. So how can we be a present there? How can the community celebrate? And there is an element that is very helpful for synodality. The communities can tell us how they would like to celebrate, considering their popular piety, which is passed on from one generation to the next, and that has fed these communities, has nourished these communities, and sometimes we pay no attention or not sufficient attention to them in our pastoral activities. And these communities help us be an increasingly evangelizing church. Perhaps another aspect, when we have to make decisions, everybody has a right to vote except the bishop. So the evangelization guidelines, how to be a church, well, all those who are present can vote. Evangelization options, everybody votes. But as a bishop, I don't wish to vote, because they are the church. All those who are present are the church, and they represent the communities. And these communities, these persons, help us truly to be an increasingly evangelizing church, a church that is to be seen as the church of the poor. Thank you. Who's next?
Thank you very much. Michael Haynes for LifeSite News. It's a question for His Eminence Cardinal Steiner. Your Eminence, you've previously gone on public record for calling for same-sex blessings, and I think you you mentioned that with regard to church teaching on sexuality, we have to read the signs of the times on what should and shouldn't change. In a previous press briefing, I referred to the CDF's document on the pastoral care of homosexual persons regarding pastoral approaches, which would always appreciate the need for homosexual persons to avoid the near occasions of sin. But in light of Cardinal Hollerich's recent statements over, I think, the last couple of days about the small discussion groups needing to have concrete steps, do you see that the Synod would present some concrete steps of change on this issue, particularly in light of the questions, I think, possibly from the module just finished regarding persons, LGBT persons, or persons in polygamous relationships and so forth? Thank you very much.
Obrigado pela pergunta.
Thank you for your question. Well, the topic has been addressed during our reflections, but also during the different round of interventions. This synodal session is not going to lead to conclusions or determinations. It is the wish of the Holy Father that the next session will look to that. But it is a good thing that this debate has come up on these topics. Let us not forget what Pope Francis said in Lisbon: the Church is for everyone. And he said so in Portuguese, so for every human being. All of us, we have all listened to interventions, and we shall see what comes up. But as far as concrete issues are concerned, well, they will have to be addressed during the next year session.
Grazie.
Thank you. Dermot Pepper from The Journal. It's an Irish outlet. And I suppose just to Wyatt, if I could ask you a question. I was just struck by Father Timothy Radcliffe this morning said that young people all over the world are taking us in new directions. And obviously you're the youngest member of the Synod. And he said that young people like you are taking the church in new directions. And I know there has to be discernment, and you can't, there's maybe a limit to what you can say, but would you be able to give us some type of insight as a young person as to what direction you would like to see the church moving?
I think the Holy Father, he really emphasizes this, the Synod as sacred silence, right? And I think I could have an idea, but I think truly the Holy Spirit is going to guide us. And so I don't think I can have this agenda. Like, if we go into this Synod and in conversation in spirit, it kind of crushes that personal agenda, right? So I truly think that the Holy Spirit will guide us. And I don't know where that is, but I full-heartedly trust in the Holy Spirit and that he will guide us. So I'm just in here for the ride, and I know the Holy Spirit will take us to good places.
Next question, the gentleman over there. I forget his name. Franco Ferraro, Missione Oggi. I have two questions, one for His Eminence concerning the method of the conversation. In the document of the Continental Assembly, there is an item where we read that the method chosen by Latin America, which is that our job, see, judge, and act, this should be integrated with the method of the clinical conversation. This is what the gentleman calls it, which is not deprived of problems. And because you have made this experience during the Synod, can you tell us about the pros and cons of this method of the conversation, and if it is actually something that can be integrated with the method adopted by the Latin American Church? The second question is for the youngest member of the Synod and the witness of the synodal journey. And it concerns the following. The synthesis report from North America is marked by doubts on this synodal journey. So my question is, after this, or in light of this experience, in your view, in your opinion, concerning what you have experienced, is it this enough to go beyond this serious doubts expressed by North American faithful in connection with the Synod? Thank you for your question. I don't see any contradictions between this this way proposed by the Synod and what we do normally in South America, see, judge, and decide. As far as we are concerned in our archdiocese, we do not use this method, but we see, judge, and decide. Is all based, we base ourselves on the Word of God, and based on this, we see, we judge, and we act. The way that we are following in the Synod allows us to see, it's going to help us judge, assess, let's say, and at the third stage, it will help us act and get to some conclusions. I see no contradiction in this. And also, highlighting, listening to the spirit. It's something that can be done in silence. Reality merges and also differences come up, but they need to be shed light on, enlightened, and that's why during the Synod there's always a theologian who intervenes. There are witnesses who intervene, so we see, then there is this assessment or judgment stage, and we undoubtedly we will get to the action stage. Sometimes we are under the impression that there are these stages are not there, but they are very present. In fact, we have highlighted the most of the conversation in the spirit, but in the dynamics of the synodal assembly, there will be these three different phases. The first two are already ongoing. Thank you, Your Eminence. Now, Wyatt, the floor is yours if you want to give an answer concerning the doubts that emerged in this document. The colleague said that from the documental, some doubts were expressed in North America. And if this experience is demonstrating that these doubts can be overcome.
So yeah, this is how I would say. It's okay to be uncomfortable. Sometimes that's how we grow. We have to be put in these uncomfortable situations. This is all new for everyone. I'm 19 years old and this is new for me too, okay? But I think this is important. And to truly trust the Holy Spirit and stuff like that. We truly have to go in, and it's gonna be uncomfortable for a lot of us, but that's how we grow. You just have to be uncomfortable and be okay with the Holy Spirit's gonna take us places, and we don't know where that's it, but we have to fully trust in the Holy Spirit.
Okay. Sandro, prego.
Sandro Magister, Espresso. The question is for Paolo Ruffini. The number of members who were present to today's session are similar to those that we were given on the occasion of the other days of the Synod. And these are presences are quite low vis-à-vis the total number of members of the Synod, which is 464. I would like to ask, those who are absent, do they have to justify their absence to someone? And what are the reasons for these absences? Because if we are speaking about 25 or 30%, it's quite high. No, perhaps we have not been clear. The voting, there are 365 voting members in the Synod, and the number you are mentioning includes all the others too, also the secretariat, staff, etc. So we do not consider the presence of also the members of the secretariat. We only count the members who are in the hall. Those who are in the hall have a tablet
which can be used to show their presence, to say that they are present. I think today there were 348 on 365, so the absent person, the absentees are less than you said. Well, some people had COVID, some people had to leave because there were some deaths. So the presence is higher than 90%, so there is clearly a misunderstanding here, and I apologize if it's our fault, if we are not being clear enough. The interpreter apologizes, but we cannot answer the question. We do not count the members who do not have voting rights. We only count the members who have got voting rights. Casalini is a member, is a special invitee. So he's not a voting member, he's a special guest. So only the voting members, those who are with the right to vote, are counted. Gianluca, let us continue that way, on that side.
Standard, Dziennik Standard de la Slovakia.
I have two questions. I'm from Slovakia. According to the canon code, the synod should strengthen the union with the Pope, promote faith, morality, and strengthen ecclesial discipline, church discipline. So my question for the participants, is this what is actually happening, according to you? And the second question is, you speak a lot about the Holy Spirit. So also in light of the recent declarations by cardinals that this is not a synod of the bishops, but of the promoters of homosexuals, who have been rejected by the church. Can you, those of you who are here, particularly the Catholic ones, can you actually confirm that the Holy Spirit can tell someone or can strengthen or push someone to say that the blessing of homosexuals is okay, is acceptable, that the Holy Spirit can actually agree with this? I would just like you to reassure those who feel confused about this. We could ask the two bishops if they would like to give an answer. Monsignor Sankiewicz. First of all, we need to be faithful to the Holy Scriptures and to what the Church for 2,000 years has, let's say, discovered by interpreting the Holy Scriptures. And the official attitude of the Church towards homosexuals was expressed in the Catechism of the Catholic Church. It means that they are called upon to live in chastity. And here we need to specify that the orientation is not a sin per se, but it should be faced. And if they start a sexual relation with another person, and this is not just for homosexuals, but for everyone, it is a sin. Every sexual relation outside of marriage is a sin. If we speak about the blessing, I would say that if an homosexual comes as an individual and asks that he wishes to live in the grace of God, I see that there are no contraindications in terms of praying for this person and help him. Then if two come and they say, we want to live in chastity and we want to face and to have our relationship, we are tempted, well, we can pray with them and also bless them to help them live in chastity. But if two persons come, well, we live together as husband and wife and we want to receive a blessing, here I see that there is a big problem, because this way we would bless living in sin. This is more or less how I see it. But another thing which is very important
And I am making reference to what His Eminence quoted. The Pope in Lisbon said, todos, 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 oh, everyone, everyone, everyone. It means that in the church there is a room for everybody. It means that the church doesn't reject anyone. And in this case, speaking with a homosexual in Latvia, I think it was a couple of years ago, I remember saying, I'm sorry that the church in the past centuries treated homosexuals as not as a mother, but as a stepmother, because the church is a mother to everyone, also to sinners, because we are all sinners. And it means that we must welcome persons with love without judging them. The Catechism says we have to respect their human dignity, and we must not discriminate them unfairly, unjustly, but in the sense that we welcome persons with love and respect, but true love cannot be separated from truth, because if truth is separated, love is separated from truth, it's no longer real love, because it becomes just being permissive, and we just harm people. So if there's a person who lives in sin and we tell this person everything is okay, well, go on like this, we're doing something negative to this person, because this person is in danger. When this person dies, you know, this person's in a great spiritual danger. So here I think we need a new sensitivity and a new approach versus what it was before, because I can also say about myself that I went through a pastoral conversion, because in the past I just judged these persons, and also looking at the way in which the Holy Father encourages us to say, well, who am I to judge the others? Little by little, I started understanding that it is evident, but you know, you have to go through a process to discover that Jesus says that we must love our neighbor, not just our neighbor, but also our enemy. So I was enlightened in a sense, and also homosexuals are my neighbors, and I must love them. But how? Love in truth, so a true love, not just love, which is just, you know, permissiveness. Thank you. Thank you, Your Excellency. Perhaps His Excellency David would like to add something.
I'm looking at this from the Filipino and Asian perspective. I can see that this is a real concern, especially in the Northern Hemisphere. And you know, I'm not being critical of the culture of the Northern Hemisphere, but I see a strong tendency to label people according to gender, sexuality, political affiliation, religion, and all of that. Where I come from, we're just human beings. You know, in the Filipino language, there is the same word for man and woman. if I'm talking about a person, I just say tao, and that tao can be a male or a female, a man or a woman. It's a basic human being. And I think Jesus also looked at every fellow human being that way, as potential sons and daughters of God. You see, even Jesus was accused of socializing with people of bad reputation, with tax collectors, prostitutes, and sinners, people who are labeled as public sinners, you know. But he didn't mind being in their company, because they're also human beings, and they're also called to be sons and daughters of God, and a lot of wonderful things happened to their lives when they encountered him. And we try to follow that same mindset.
Grazie, Eccellenza. Allora, abbiamo tempo per una.
Thank you, Your Excellency. We have time for one more question. Thank you.
Grazie.
Lisa Allen, Crooks. I have two questions.
Two quick questions, one for Mr. Olivas and one for His Eminence David. First of all, I would like to know, in terms of the American church, you know, much of the public discourse with everything, but especially in the lead-up to the Synod, is sort of dominated by the Anglo perspective. But of course, there's a strong Latino Catholic community in the States as well. And so I'm wondering if there were any, if you perceived any differences in terms of perspective and priorities in terms of the Latino Catholic community versus, you know, the Anglo Catholic community in the United States. And my second question for Mr. David is, I'm very happy that you brought up the missionary situation in the Philippines, because I'd wanted you to ask about that and whether the fact that there are so many missionaries throughout the world and so many just Filipino communities throughout the world, has that created some unique pastoral challenges for the Philippines, and what are some of the other priorities for your church? Thank you.
Perfect. So I'll start off with... I think everyone comes in and has ideas, right? But especially back home, like I was saying earlier, people can come in with personal agendas and stuff like that. But I truly think in this listening, it's gathering it all together, and it's not putting it in a melting pot and just saying, it's like making a salad, I don't know. And it's throwing these ideas together and really praying on it, really having the Holy Spirit guide it. You can't... I mean, people can come in with personal agendas, but the Holy Spirit truly crushes that. And I think back home, I think there were some different ideas, but I think coming together was an important part, and listening to each other was an important part, and praying on the conversation and stuff. Thank you.
Okay. I mentioned that the Filipinos, especially the overseas Filipino workers, are finding themselves in new situations all over the world and are forced by circumstances to become what we call accidental missionaries, you know. They don't go out to engage in mission. They are workers, and they usually come from the poorest sectors of the Philippine society. And there you will see how God works somehow through the Church of the Poor. Many of these people, even in the Philippines, are not very serious about their religion, about their faith. But when they are suddenly find themselves in a situation where they feel so alienated, they hold on to their faith as their only source of strength and moral courage. And so they become more serious about their faith just when they find themselves as aliens in foreign lands. And that's how they become accidental missionaries, you know, when they really witness to their faith to their host countries. And they don't go out to proselytize, you know. It's the attractiveness of their effort to live the gospel as Christians that sometimes influences other people. But it's not all romantic, you know. These are human beings. They have problems. And so you mentioned about pastoral challenges. Oh, there are lots of them. Many of these people who, you know, are separated from their families, they're working abroad, and they send money to their families in the Philippines, sometimes would get involved in illicit relationships, and then before you know it, they're maintaining two or three families already. They're human beings like you and me. And they're also, that's why they're crying for some pastoral accompaniment, especially in their host countries. And it's good if the host countries are able to provide the pastoral accompaniment. And if they are not able to provide it, usually the local churches in the host countries would write to us in the Philippines to send, you know, missionary chaplains who can help out in providing pastoral care for the migrant Filipinos in their countries. You know, here, right here in Italy, you won't believe it, no? The pastoral care is being provided, you know, by that commission for migrants, because they're considered as migrants. But in effect, they're not able to integrate themselves into the local Italian communities, you know? And I have a good friend who is a migrant here in Italy. His children are born in Italy, and his children are Italians. In the school, they're integrated with fellow Italians. But in the church, they're segregated. They don't feel they belong to the Italian church. They don't feel they belong to the Filipino church either, because they are already educated differently. That's why they're crying out to the Italian church, please, yes, we're Filipinos, but we're Italians already. We would like to have contact with fellow young people who are Italians because, you know, they're already, they want to insert themselves and to be accepted also as Italians of Filipino origin. I hope you see my what I'm pointing out as a big pastoral challenge that is not only for us, but also for the church here in Italy.
So time is up. I'm sorry. Thank you very much for being here. I would like to thank warmly our guests, and I would like them to stay because so that we can take a picture. Perhaps some colleagues would like to take some pictures. Thank you for being here. Thank you, colleagues, for being here with us, and see you tomorrow.
And with that, we conclude this live-streamed broadcast of the Wednesday briefing at the 16th General Assembly of the Synod of Bishops. Please visit our Vatican News web portal for more coverage of the Synod General Assembly. My name is Devin Watkins, and it has been a pleasure to provide the English translation for you. Laudetur Jesus Christus. Praised be Jesus Christ.